Dave Lee Travis, Simon Bates, Bruno Brooks, Gary Davis. These were the most famous voices of a generation. Every week, 20 million listeners tuned in to their shows on Radio 1. But in the mid-1990s, two close friends were appointed to revamp Britain's favourite radio station. One was a polished and sharp-suited manager, driven by corporate ambition. The other, a maverick music producer with a massive record collection. This is the story of how these two men, in their efforts to make Radio 1 young again, mercilessly butchered the careers of Britain's top disc jockeys. And of how the flame-haired superstar they hoped would save the station became a ginger nail in the coffin of their 20-year friendship. In 1967, Radio 1 started life as the voice of youth. 20 years on, it had become a national institution, a temple to pop music. And the DJs had become huge celebrities, bigger than the pop stars whose records they were playing.
You had, well, about 24 million listeners a week in those days. You knew you wanted something big, but you didn't really think about it. I mean, everybody got on very well, I suppose, in a very small way, like they do in Hollywood.
But behind the scenes, a young Radio 1 newsreader was less than impressed.
I was never a real fan of Radio 1, I have to say. It wasn't exactly the station of hip youth. It was the station your mum listened to.
And his friend and mentor, producing the station's most popular programme, was tearing his hair out with frustration.
I can remember vividly sitting on the top of my stairs at home on a Monday morning when I was due to go to work to produce the Dave Lee Travis show, and just bursting into tears and saying, I can't do this anymore, you know. There's got to be more to life than this, because it was a terrible, terrible job.
Matthew and Trevor left Radio 1 to seek a more natural home for their ambition and creativity, unaware that they would one day return to wreak a terrible revenge on the station they had grown to abhor. They went to work in BBC local radio, rising through the ranks and eventually running Greater London Radio in hugely successful partnership.
He's a music expert who understands programming music and has worked in music radio for most of his career and music television. And I'm a manager.
He liked drinking and he liked smoking. And at the time, you know, so did I. So we had quite a lot in common, really. So we were pretty close.
In just 2 years, they turned this ailing station into the award-winning home of the nation's most inventive new broadcasters. But while Trevor and Matthew collected accolades for modernising GLR, Radio 1 had remained anchored to its heritage.
It's just coming up to 12:45.
What should have been a flagship youth station was catering to aging Gary Davis fans. And teenage listeners were being lured away to hip new commercial stations. Then, in 1993, the BBC decided it was time for a change. Just 10 years after he'd first set foot in Radio 1, Matthew strode triumphantly through the portals of its headquarters, Egton House. No longer a newsreader, but now the station's new controller. He was charged with making the station feel young again. Was about to embark upon the most radical overhaul in the station's 25-year history. But he had reckoned without Radio 1's special culture.
I think Matthew was a bit optimistic about how easy it would be to persuade the staff of the necessity for change.
I didn't expect to be carried shoulder high around the building, but on the other hand, I was surprised when I got there to find how entrenched the culture was. I remember going into the typing pool where all the girls sat, who filled out the forms and ordered the records up from the library and so on, and somebody looking up and saying, "What the hell do you want?"
Entirely unaware, Matthew had stumbled into the sacred heart of Radio 1.
The typing pool! How dare he call it a bloody typing pool? I think the Radio 1 girls run everything. The Radio 1 girls were a tribe of Amazons. They ran the whole lot. And to dismiss them as typists it's an obscenity. I hate him for that.
Matthew's first task was to clear the jungles of the nation's favourite station of the dinosaurs that had roamed the airwaves for so many years and replace them with new and younger voices.
There were a number of DJs who were older than the Prime Minister, the Director General of the BBC and the Archbishop of Canterbury. In fact, one of them was an old age pensioner. Now, I'm not ageist about people. You can have people of 70 broadcasting to young people, but if the whole cast of characters is somehow massively out of touch with youth culture, then you really have a problem.
Determined to show Britain's youth that Radio 1 was entering a brand new Matthew Bannister era, the new controller planned to turn the spotlight on his aging DJs one last time by sacking them.
You don't want to hurt people unnecessarily, but sometimes you do have to show that you have taken the decision.
But before he could get his hands on the axe, his first and biggest prey flew the nest. Dave Lee Travis announced live to 15 million listeners that he was quitting Radio 1.
Changes are being made here that go against my principles, and I just cannot agree with them. And I really want to put the record straight at this point, and I thought that you ought to know first.
Dave Lee Travis's departure had not gone entirely to plan. But Matthew was in confident mood. After all, there were plenty more dinosaurs left in Egton House. The big money was on Simon Bates being the next to go. But just as Matthew was about to execute his coup de grace, Simon Bates did a DLT on him.
I was called by the press office one morning to say that there was a story running on a news agency that Simon Bates was leaving Radio 1. So I popped into his studio where he was doing the Golden Hour and said, "Simon, you know, there's this story you're leaving." Yes. I said, "Do you have anything to do with that?" Well, these things get out, don't they, you know? And I said, "Well, as it happens, we didn't have a plan to renew your contract when it came up in 3 months' time. But I wish it hadn't been announced like this. And I wonder if you mind leaving the building through the side entrance."
But the wily Bates insisted on leaving through the front entrance. He now presented what should have been Matthew's first and most spectacular sacking as his own triumphant resignation. Now, determined not to let any more of his DJs get the better of him, Matthew plunged into his task with fearless zest. The cull could now begin. In earnest. Within months, self-styled medallion man Gary Davis, whispering Bob Harris, Alan Freeman, Jackie Brambles, and Johnny Walker had all been Bannistered.
They were just dismissed as if they were nothing, as if there was something on the bottom of your shoe. We just thought, who's next? And every day, somebody was getting fired. It was very, very ugly.
And each time another dinosaur crashed under the axe of Matthew Bannister, the press became more and more interested in Radio 1.